Hey guys, in this video, let's see about claw hand. It's characterized by hyperextension at metacarpophalangeal joints and flexion at interphalangeal joints. The causes of claw hand may be ulnar nerve palsy, which is seen in cubital tunnel syndrome, ulnar tunnel syndrome, median nerve palsy, which is seen in Ehrlichman ischemic contracture, leprosy or Hansen disease, also seen in compartment syndrome of hand and Charcot-Marie tooth disease. Coming to ulnar claw hand, also called a spinster's claw, it's a deformity or an abnormal attitude of the hand that develops due to ulnar nerve damage causing paralysis of the lumbricals. A claw hand presents with a hyperextension at the metacarpophalangeal joints and a flexion at the proximal and distal interphalangeal joints of the 4th and 5th fingers. This lumbricals is responsible for the flexion of metacarpophalangeal joints and extension of interphalangeal joints normally. This is the classic ulnar claw hand you can see in this picture. Also, patient exhibiting an ulnar claw are very frequently unable to adduct or abduct their fingers against resistance. This occurs because the ulnar nerve also innervates the palmar and dorsal interossei of the hand. One more thing to be known about this is ulnar paradox. What is it? The ulnar nerve also innervates the ulnar half or the medial half of the flexor digitorum profundus muscle. If the ulnar nerve lesion occurs more proximally, which is closer to the elbow, the flexor digitorum profundus muscle may also be denervated. As a result, the flexion of interphalangeal joints is weakened, which reduces the claw-like appearance of the hand. To be precise, as re-innervation occurs along the ulnar nerve after a high lesion, the deformity will get worse, which is the flexor digitorum profundus re-innervation, as the patient recovers. Hence, the term paradox is used. A simple way to remember this is, the closer to the paw, the worse the claw. Then coming to the Dupuytren's contracture. Let's see the definition. It is a condition characterized by a flexion deformity of one or more fingers due to thickening and shortening of the palmar aponeurosis. Normally, palmar aponeurosis is a thin but tough membrane lying immediate beneath the skin of the palm, which helps to anchor and stabilize the skin. Without this fascia, the skin on your palm would be as loose and movable as the skin on the back of your hand. In patients with a Dupuytren's disease, this palmar fascia slowly begins to thicken, then tighten. Often, Dupuytren's is first detected when lumps of tissue or nodules form under the skin in the palm. This may be followed by pitting on the surface of the palm as the diseased tissue pulls on the overlying skin. As Dupuytren's progresses, bands of fascia in the palm develop into thick cords that can tether to one or more fingers and the thumb into a bent position. This is called Dupuytren's contracture. Although the cords in the palm may look like tendons, the tendons are not involved in the Dupuytren's contracture. In many cases, a Dupuytren's contracture progresses very slowly over a period of years and may remain mild enough such that no treatment is needed. In moderate or severe cases, however, the condition makes it difficult to straighten the involved digits. When this happens, treatment may be needed to help reduce the contracture and improve motion in the affected fingers. Typically, as the contracture worsens, the involvement of the fascia becomes more severe and treatment is less likely to result in a full correction. Then coming to Ehrlichman ischemic contracture. Ehrlichman ischemic contracture is a deformity of the hand, fingers and wrist caused by the injury to the muscles of the forearm. The condition is called Ehrlichman ischemic contracture. Ehrlichman contracture occurs when there is a lack of blood flow or ischemia to the forearm. This occurs when there is increased pressure due to swelling, a condition called compartment syndrome. Injury to the arm, including a crush injury or fracture, can lead to swelling that presses on the blood vessels and decreases the blood flow to the arm. A prolonged decrease in blood flow injures the nerves and muscles, causing them to become stiff and shortened. When the muscle shortens, it pulls on the joint at the end of the muscle just as it were normally contracted. Because it is stiff, the joints remain bent and stuck. This leads to the condition of a contracture. In Ehrlichman contracture, the muscles of the forearm are severely injured. This leads to contracture deformities of the hands and wrist. There are three levels of severity in Ehrlichman contracture: mild, moderate, severe. In mild condition, contracture of 2 or 3 fingers only, with no or limited loss of feeling. In moderate condition, all the fingers are bent and the thumb is stuck in the palm. The wrist may be bent, stuck, and there is usual loss of some feeling in the hand. In severe condition, all the muscles in the forearm that both flex and extend the wrist and fingers are involved. This is a severely disabling condition. Conditions that can cause increased pressure in the forearm include animal bites, a forearm fracture, bleeding disorders, burns, excessive exercise, injection of certain medicine into the forearm, injury of blood vessel in the forearm, surgery on the forearm. I hope you guys understood the difference between the claw hand in the ulnar nerve lesion, Dupuytren's contracture and Volkmann ischemic contracture. Thank you guys, and let's see in the next video. If you haven't subscribed my channel yet, please do subscribe and send to your friends. Thank you.